Hello, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Fireside Chat number 51, Fictional Fighting Men, with Alan Franson. Alan Franson is an American medievalist with a specialization in Old English literature. Since retiring from Loyola University in Chicago, he has been an emeritus professor. He has written numerous books, such as Bloody Good, Chivalry, Sacrifice, and the Great War, Food, Eating, and Identity in Early Medieval England, Before the Closet, Same-Sex Love, From Beowulf to Angels in America, and Anglo-Saxon Keywords, Keywords in Literature and Culture. And we're bringing him on as a guest. We've had him on before, and I thought he was such a good guest, we're going to bring him back. So welcome to the show, Alan. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Nice to be back.
All right. So first, I guess, for some of our new viewers that may not know that you've been on a couple times before, why don't you tell us a little bit about how you came to find yourself coming on a show like Honey Badger Radio after some controversy? I believe you wrote an essay that got you into a little bit of trouble.
Right. I've been working on a book. I've been working for a while on a book on boxing and masculinity. And I started putting parts of the book up on a website just to see what they would look like and what kind of response I would get. I had sent proposals for the book to numerous publishers, all of whom turned it down. Most of whom didn't even respond because, in fact, when I looked through literary agents and wrote to them as a way of accessing publishers, almost all of them were women, and I could find dozens and dozens of references to women's studies and gender studies and so on and so forth, and absolutely nothing about masculinity. And I realized that the traditional publishing door just was not going to open for me outside of academia for a book on boxing and masculinity. So I put a little bit of it up on the web, and it came to the attention of some progressive feminists who really were outraged. I think what happened was that they had assumed, because I'd been in the profession for a long time, they know that I'm gay, that they figured that my politics and their politics were the same. I mean, that was just it. They had no idea who I was, but they just assumed that I agreed with them on everything. And it became apparent in the course of the criticism of the effect of feminism on men that I was making in some parts of this website that, I became, as you called me when we first met, I'd become a pariah. And the more that, that was about a year ago, and one can only see that this trend in academia has intensified tremendously in the year since then. This whole idea that professionals have some kind of right to freedom of speech seems to have gone out the window, that the progressives, or as some people call them, illiberals, pretty much insist on dominating the discussion. So I stood outside the discussion, and that's where all the controversy started. But I stand in a long and proud line of men who have been, criticized and attacked and bullied, really, I would say, for standing outside, mainstream view on things like feminism and also on violence. So I think that's kind of a thumbnail of how I got here. Mm-hmm. Does that sound cool?
Yes, that sounds right on. And were you surprised that that feminists expected you to share politics with them just because you're a homosexual man?
No, I wasn't surprised. I mean, one of the most dismaying things about academia in the nearly 40 years that I was in it was how it became more and more exclusive in terms of the kinds of people who joined the profession. And any kind of dissent from established positions. Even, for example, I would go to gender studies meetings and I would try to talk about men, but this was just outrageous. And at the time I had a career to protect and I thought, well, I can see why nobody speaks up for men, mm-hmm. Unless they're criticizing men as abusers of women, because it's just not a topic that feminists are prepared to listen to. When I retired, I thought I would escape from that. But I think that there's always a lot of old resentment that comes up in these cases. I was very surprised to be attacked personally by people I'd lent money to, by people whose hotel rooms I had, hotel bills I paid because they didn't have money. by people whose essays I'd published in my work. And I had a whole basket full of fond email from some of these same people. And the next thing I know, I mean, they were attacking me very viciously, publicly, as if they didn't know who I was. So kind of a bully mentality there, I think. I thought for a while about writing an essay I was going to call Bully for Feminism. But I decided I had enough. And as I look in the world around me, I see a lot of academic men in academia, and once in a while women, getting similar treatment. It's not really a surprise. I think what's surprising is that they claim to be, in their own way, non-judgmental, but they make extraordinary assumptions about people based on little bits of biographical information.
Oh, yeah.
That's what happened to me.
Yeah, absolutely. So when you said you thought that after you retired, you would have escaped it, but
yeah,
you didn't.
I mean,
so this stuff followed you afterwards? Is it just in those sort of personal interactions you were talking about where you had people that have attacked you despite the fact that you helped them in ways like you were, you know, paid for their hotel rooms, printed their work in your books, yeah, things like that?
Yeah. You know, I think a lot of these people are hungry for targets. And I think some of them didn't know I had retired. But as I said to somebody who interviewed me about this, if I'd known how big I was, I would have asked my boss for more money. And, you know, the professionals I talked to in public relations and other areas, they said, well, I think, you know, this is obviously a lot of abuse you're taking, but the fact is the ideas that you are advocating make a difference to them. And this is just some sign that these ideas about men are worth advocating for because there's a lot of resistance to them. And I think that's where I found the conversations that we had to be very helpful. You know, Karen's work, for example, and the work of other people I could see were connected to the Badger Brigade, mm-hmm, are all espousing unpopular points of view, but it's really great to know that there's a community there of people who can agree with each other, and that there's more than one or two of us.
Yeah, and we don't have a problem disagreeing with each other either. We kind of work towards trying to find what the truth is, trying to pull back the veil, as it were, and mm-hmm, look at stuff, no matter how uncomfortable it might make us. Because that's what a lot of this, I think, has to do with, especially when you're discussing gender. It's about going and looking at uncomfortable truths that men and women deal with, and being honest with yourself about it. And a lot of times I think that, you know, these ideological orthodoxies in, like, feminism, for example, they can't do that. They can't engage in that. It's risky for them.
Right. I think one reason for that, and this is something else I saw overtaking academia in the course of my work, the university has become a place for advocacy. It didn't used to be, but the classroom became a place for advocacy, and feminism and gender studies were leading the charge there, I think. Mm-hmm. That it wasn't a place to talk about ideas or discuss two sides of an issue. It was a place for advocating.
It was where you made activists. It wasn't so much where you challenged ideas and you sort of hashed things out and asked difficult questions.
No, that's absolutely out of the question now. I remember maybe it was 15 years ago that we had a visiting speaker. We went out to dinner. I was sitting at a table with my colleagues, and one of them said that her point in teaching her history courses was to turn her students into, as she called them, good little Democrats. I laughed because I thought she was making a joke, but she wasn't joking.
Wow.
And I thought, well, isn't that, I mean, good little Democrats. I wouldn't even have said it. But the idea that my job as a professor was to turn a student into a member of a political party, it never crossed my mind.
Mm-hmm.
But I was clearly the outlier there. I was clearly the person who thought that this was, you know, an odd thing to do in the classroom.
It seemed, I don't know if sort of creepy or unethical, or there's something wrong with it.
Well, I think it's unethical. I think you're exactly right, because who holds the power in that situation?
Mm-hmm.
Who's passing out the grade? You know, whose judgments go down on paper? It's the professors. And it's coercive. So you know, a lot of students are very cynical about this. They say whatever they think the professor wants to hear. And I must say, I don't blame them, because they're being coerced.
Yeah. And they're also being told that, you know, you need the degree. So what are you willing to do to get the degree?
I think this is shocking for students of, you know, of many different kinds of backgrounds. Students who've got a strong religious persuasion from one kind or another have to be insulted by this kind of treatment. Mm-hmm. And it is insulting and degrading. And yet I don't really see that the student has a way to defend himself or herself or speak up here. So I think your calling it unethical is exactly right. I think it's an abuse of power.
Yeah, I think so too. So let's talk about your book. I want to talk a little bit about Before the Closet, again, because we have some new people. So tell us about briefly about what Before the Closet, Same-Sex Love from Beowulf to Angels in America. What was the thing that made you want to write it, and what is it at its core? What is it about?
Well, what made me want to write it was the feeling that was very strong in the 1990s, and I think it was the fallout from queer theory, that any time two men sat down together on a park bench, there was some kind of sexual implication to this intimacy. There was something queer about it. And queer always got sidetracked into some kind of physical sexual contact. I wrote Before the Closet because I wanted to demonstrate that it was a long tradition in the military and in courtly affairs among men, that there was a lot of physical intimacy that wasn't sexual. And I wanted to point that out and just to set out the history of male closeness that really couldn't be subverted into some kind of a sexual discussion. That's why I called it Before the Closet. The whole idea of the closet, the implication there is that there's sexual behavior that needs to be hidden. Men in the Middle Ages didn't feel that they needed to hide their affection from each other. And
when you say, I'm sorry to interrupt, when you say this sort of like came out of the 1990s in this queer theory, I'm getting some people in the chat asking, what is queer theory? And when you say this is coming, this attitude, this sort of implication that men that are spending time together, they must be, you know, have some kind of,
sexual
gay attraction to each other or sexual attraction to each other.
Right. So, I think what queer theory was about, I mean, it's really come and gone, although queer studies was a big thing for a long time in the 90s, there was this feeling that even though you said it wasn't sexual, it really was, that everything sooner or later could be boiled down to a sexual context. Any kind of intimacy translated into sex, that's what made it queer. And that somehow orthodox sources resisted this, but in fact, as I tried to point out in the book, there was a lot of talking about physical intimacy between men, even among Quakers in the 19th century. People of the same sex sharing a bed was an accepted and acknowledged thing, and the idea that this was somehow transgressive did not occur to them. Queer studies is very heavily invested in the idea of the transgressive, and it tried to make any same-sex relationship a transgressive one, and I thought that was nonsense. That's why I wrote the book.
Mm-hmm. And I just had this thought, though. So what you're essentially trying to talk about in the book is men being close to other men is not new, and it's not necessarily sexual.
Right, exactly.
And it doesn't have to be. Now, here's the thing I remembered. The reason why I brought this up is while it may no longer be called queer studies or queer theory, I have noticed a lot of progressive news outlets or media outlets that write articles about how straight men should engage in homosexual behavior because it would be good for them. And This is really encouraged. Like over and over, I see it. You know, men having sex with other men that are straight, and so this way they can be comfortable with, you know, being men. This is the way you do it, or giving each other oral sex or hand jobs or whatever. And I thought that was really strange that they were trying to essentially shame heterosexual men that may have no interest in that whatsoever, and telling them there's something wrong with them because they don't.
And right, good for you. I think you put your finger right on it. It's an attempt to shame men who participate in what these people call heteronormativity, and to shame them into some kind of transgressive behavior. Mm-hmm. They want these men to feel like victims. And what they're exercising, I think, it is a form of bullying. I think these people are trying to demonstrate their moral superiority. They know what's better for these men than the men themselves. Mm-hmm. I used to say to students, if you wanted to find out what your politics were, just tell people you were a gay man, and they would start telling you right away what you believed in and who you voted for.
Yeah, exactly.
That's how it works. I mean, they're strongly identified with the transgressive, and they are determined that nobody should enjoy what they consider the privilege of normalcy. But I think you're right that their tool for this is shame, which is always a dishonorable tool.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the and a lot of men are shockingly susceptible to shame.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It works, and it is cowardly. That's what I would call it. I think it's a coward's tool.
It is a coward's tool, and it is a form of bullying. I really felt that a year ago when I was reading the things that these people, some of whom, you know, I had worked with for many, many years, the things that they were saying about me. I thought, well, you know, these people are bullies. I didn't realize this. And in this bullying situation, it's the bullies who have the problem. People who are trying to bully straight men into homosexual relationships it is a form of bullying, and they're trying to demonstrate their moral superiority.
Oh yeah, I mean, the reverse of that would not be acceptable.
Can you
right?
imagine? Can you yeah. imagine? It was the first thing I thought about. You can imagine that, and of course, you know, traditionally, many gay men were shamed into struggling through heterosexual relationships just to survive.
Mm-hmm.
That, of course, is decried as very abusive, but these people turn around and exercise the same tool themselves.
Yeah.
They are amazingly unself-aware of their doubles.
I wonder, though, and I've asked myself this, well, I think I know what it's all about, but what do you think would be the reason for doing that, for trying to shame, other than perhaps to claim the moral high ground, what would be the point in trying to convince men or shame men into homosexual relationships, or at least homosexual encounters?
To acquire power over them.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it is perfectly obvious to acquire power over them. That's what progressives and illiberals are trying to do. They want to acquire power over the opposition, and shame is a great tool for doing that.
Yeah.
They want to tell people what to do. They want everybody to live the way they want to live, and this is what they seek: a world of people like themselves. That's my answer to your question.
No, I think that's right. I think that illiberals, they're mostly motivated by envy and disgust towards outgroups. And one of the biggest outgroups is the straight male. They don't like masculinity. They think masculinity is toxic just by its very nature. They don't like men. They don't really fully understand it, and they don't even know where they're going with it ultimately, because they don't know what it's one of those where you have a problem, and you think that your drastic short-term solution will be effective without thinking about the long-term consequences, even if you are able to follow through on it. Because I think that you can write articles about how men should have sex with other men, despite their actual sexual orientation mm-hmm. till the cows come home, and there'll be straight men that will say, no, I don't want to do that. But mm-hmm. even if somehow in your, you know, utopic thinking brain, you manage to get that done, mm-hmm. the consequences for that will be far more negative than you can imagine. Because first off, we, you know, our species sort of requires us to multiply by having sex with the opposite sex. Secondly, mm-hmm. women will be very unhappy if they can't find men. So, you yeah. know, and I mean, by and large, you know, there's a lot of unhappiness in women today. And I think a lot of it has to do with the stuff that the progressives are trying to force them into, you know.
I think you put your finger on something important about their anger. I think their anger is really unfocused. I think that's something that you said at the beginning of this comment that's really worth looking at. There, I don't know if, apart from disruption, they have got an aim. But I think their anger is very unfocused and really omnidirectional. I mean, they can be angry about just about anything. Tremendous indignation all the time, and very unfocused. I can't see that it works in a particular direction. But I think what it gets at is that the only position that they feel comfortable in is an oppositional one,
mm-hmm.
and they have somehow managed to merge anger and opposition. And in doing this, I think they lose a lot of political power, the very thing that I think they're interested in. Because it's hard to see what they do stand for and very easy to see what they stand against. Even their reading of my work, I think, is an example of this. They didn't see what I wrote about boxing and masculinity as being something in favor of men. They saw it as something attacking women.
Of course.
And I mean, almost anybody who writes anything critically of feminism, male or female, is going to be called a misogynist. That's just their stock in trade. But it's a kind of unfocused anger. I don't think it's got a lot of principle behind it.
No.
Except they're right and we're wrong. Mm-hmm. And we have to submit. We have to have sex with men because then they can see us as members of a victim class that they can manage. I think that's what they really like to do, yeah. is to manage victims.
Yeah, I mean, speaking of submit, I think that their lack in foresight with the way that they, you know, they're more about standing in opposition, as you were saying. So they know what they're standing against, they just don't know what they're standing for. That's one of the reasons why they partner up with Islam, for example, which is like they have a common enemy, but they don't realize what, you know, what they're partnering with is in many ways does a lot of the same things that they tend to stand against, but even more so. But because they share a common enemy, which is, you know, Western capitalist, white, cis, male,
yes.
whatever, then they're just like, well, we don't care if you guys, you know, what your issues are, because you guys hate the people that we hate. So we're going to go after them together, and we're going to defend you to do it.
You talked about groups that lie outside their purview. I think one thing that motivates them is a takedown of the Judeo-Christian tradition mm-hmm. itself. And that's why their blindness, their indifference to the status of women in Islam is astonishing to me. But they can't criticize it because Islam is a tool for them to attack the Judeo-Christian tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And that's highly motivating to them. So they're just silent on these questions.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And they're not going to really think too much about it. Instead, they're going to find ways to justify it, maybe. I mean, they've already started doing it. They've already started saying things. I remember one woman was on a panel, and she was a feminist woman, and she said that Islam is the most feminist of religions. And I was like, you know what? You're right in more ways than you think you are, but I'm going to let that one go because I don't disagree. But I don't think that makes it a good thing. At least not with current, you know, in the current feminism in its current form. But yeah, so let's go on to, okay, so we were talking about Before the Closet. So the point of that, or the thesis of it was what?
To argue that historically close relationships between men were essential for lots of ways of building and protecting culture, and they had nothing to do with sexual intimacy. And it was a deliberate misreading of them to go into, for example, closeness between men and chivalric relationships or in warfare, and to see all of these powerful and moving encounters between men as somehow flirtatious or somehow in some way or other having something to do with sexual intercourse. Mm-hmm. You know, men died in each other's arms. Men wept when their friends were killed in warfare. But to try to degrade all of this or to reclassify all of this as queer in somehow and therefore subversively sexual, I thought was enormously disrespectful to the sacrifice of these men.
Sounds a bit Freudian in a way, right?
Their part, on their part or my part?
On their part.
I think so. That sex is the big hidden secret. Mm-hmm. That's essential to queer theory. Sex is the big hidden secret. And you know, I think the most reductive thing about their approach is that it's that we are as people who we are sexually. That the main marker of identity is sexual identity. That's why they're so excited about transgender, you know. Anything that stands outside of or defies classification or boundaries, that's a status that they seek.
Well, they've actually transcended transgender now, and they've got they've gone on to other kinds of gender, which actually sort of flies in the face of transgender people. That's where the story with Jordan Peterson, but not limited to his deal with Bill C-16 in Canada, that essentially allows for non-binary pronouns. That became a big discussion because progressives, when we look at protests and stuff, we're mostly looking at college age or high school age kids that have learned this stuff from their professors, their teachers, and the internet, Tumblr and stuff. And they're all working with bad information, but they're so dogmatic in their belief towards it. So I wouldn't blame the kids so much as, you know, the academics that have sort of passed this on, but they've actually gone beyond trans people, whereas a trans person that undergoes a surgery and hormone therapy and all this other stuff so they can go from male to female or female to male, they are actually trying to change their sex from one to another. Yes, but right. People who are trying to essentially, you know, just change the way they dress and wear their hair cut a certain way, and they just want to look androgynous, and they take on some made-up word that represents a gender that doesn't fall into one or the other, they're not, they claim that what they do is it falls in line with trans people, but they don't realize that trans people are not concerned with pronouns by and large because they are men turning into women or women turning into men. Yeah, they're not trying to find some middle ground. And this is what the discussion is all about.
Yes, I think the origin of this idea actually goes back to some of Judith Butler's work on performativity, that we aren't male or female, that we can perform gender, that gender is a performance, and this kind of thing. It's an attempt to invent a new category, I think sometimes just because academics are so desperate to find something new to say. That they're always looking for a way to break down what you or I might think of as a category. That's where they find newness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
But I mean, the whole idea of a microaggression is a good example of this, I think. Where all of a sudden it becomes a serious term. I mean, you know, the very coinage microaggression would suggest that, geez, you know, parking tickets are bigger problems than this. You know,
absolutely.
But I think it's a way of novelty. Novelty has a lot of currency in academia. I've read something you haven't read. I've thought something you haven't thought. So it's a kind of one-upsmanship, if I may say it.
Mm-hmm.
One-up personship or whatever, personship. But it's very competitive, this idea of having to one-up somebody else by finding a new term, a new category. and then in that this way making their ideas seem obsolete.
Yeah, that's actually usually how they end up eating each other, because this is
how
you got from, you know, like, for example, progressives work with something called the progressive stack. And in the progressive stack, they have, you know, varying identity politics that that appear in sort of a hierarchy. And depending on your identity traits, you will fall in a different place in the progressive stack. For example, if you are a trans person, you're going to be higher up on the progressive stack than if you were black. If you are female, you're below black, but you're higher than male. White, straight, hetero, white heterosexual, cisgendered men of middle class are at the very bottom, because, you know, who cares about them? But as at the very top, it'd be somebody like a trans disabled Muslim, you know, a queer person or something.
Right.
So
yes, exactly.
They have this hierarchy, and I don't know if you know this, but gay men are no longer part of the hierarchy. They are privileged now. So they've been thrown out of the mix. So you're just as privileged as I am.
I'm not surprised, but I think, you know, the utter nonsense of this kind of classification just shows me how desperate they are to find something to talk about. I think part of these discussions come from the fact that they are so irrelevant, mm-hmm. and constantly having to reinvent themselves with new studies programs of one kind or another, because a lot of people really don't care about what they're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they know this.
Oh yeah, I think that's why they're doubling down. I mean, the recent election sort of shows what, despite everything, you know, people, by and large, I think they're getting tired of it, and they're starting to see this. So
yes, at the same time, as you were talking about this bill in Canada, and I was thinking about the term midshipman in the U.S. Navy, and the fact that governors in some states want to get the word man as an inclusive term out of any state document. I really wonder if there isn't some kind of very big shift going on that is slowly turning away from, in some of these interviews that Peterson has done, this mm-hmm. University of Toronto you were talking about, he talks about the abandonment of rules of evidence and rationality and this kind of thing. But I think for many people, those rules are considered obsolete. They're not troubled by the fact that their arguments are irrational. They're not troubled by the fact that they have no data or evidence for their claims.
Right.
But the standard has really shifted, you know. Mm-hmm. The university isn't a place where you talk about two sides of a question. It's a place where I advocate for my position, which is the only moral one that you are going to be allowed to hold. I mean, that's a big change, you know. And it's easier. It's easier. You don't need information. You don't need an education to be right.
No, you just need to be convicted. You just need conviction. You just need to really believe it. It's like religion. You just need to believe it enough, and that's it. You know.
Unfortunately, I think that your analogy is a very good one. It is religion to them. These are articles of faith, and they're not prepared to hear arguments to the contrary. In fact, they do their best to forbid anybody from speaking against them.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't see this as being easily turned around. Do you? How do you think this plays?
Well, there are things happening. I do have concerns that the pendulum may swing too far the other way, though. There are rumblings or talk about how, thanks to the internet, right? So there's a new generation of people that are, essentially, they've grown up with the internet as their main means of communication, of information gathering, of entertainment, of everything. And word is, this new generation called Generation Z is going to be the most, as a response to all of this progressive, illiberal, social justice warrior stuff, they're probably going to be the most conservative generation since World War II's generation. And I don't know how good that's going to be. I mean, on the one hand, I'm glad that there's going to be pushback. This is all, you know, predictive stuff. It's hard to say. But I do, you know, a part of me hopes that there isn't an overcompensation, because the reason why we're getting all of this extreme pushback is because at the base level, nobody's talking to each other. The people on both sides of the fence here are not communicating. And by and large, I would argue that it's because the left doesn't want to talk. They just want to proselytize. They just want to, essentially stand on their soapbox and preach their sermon. And they don't want any dissenting opinions. And they will use violence to stop it. I mean, there have been, I don't know if you know about the Berkeley riots that happened because Milo Yiannopoulos wanted to go speak there. And this stuff happens. You know, Antifa, who has been essentially punching people because they don't like them. Because you silence your opposition so much, it's actually going to create a stronger, you know, sort of response to that. And so a part of me is concerned that the next generation may be too conservative as a response, as opposed to trying to work out some, you know, I wouldn't say a solution that makes everyone happy, but work towards whatever the truth is and use that coupled with universal principles or universally preferable behavior. Sometimes my brain moves faster than my mouth. And
just let me interrupt if I may.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
I see the concern. But from my position, having spent close to 40 years in colleges and universities, what I see is a generation of faculty completely younger than me. I mean, I'm in my late 60s, but I'm looking at professors in their 30s who are just starting their careers, who are utterly wedded to illiberal progressive ideals. Yeah. They're only in their 30s. They're going to be around for 30 years.
Yeah. Well, I would say this.
College presidents, you know, a lot of these people have moved into administration. They're deans. I don't know if you saw this one YouTube clip with Peterson. He was introduced by a dean from some college who began by reciting the names of all the Indian tribes.
I remember that. Yes, that was in the.
I
understand that in Toronto, it's actually common practice to give sort of, you know, reverence to all of the what they call the First Nations people in Canada before you actually start using their land, as it were. It's actually pretty common to do that in Canada. We don't do that here in the States, as far as I know. But
no, yeah. We don't. But well, I'm saying.
Let me reiterate, in the University of Toronto. I'm not going to speak for all the universities, but go ahead.
University administrations and university faculty are heavily stacked with illiberals and progressives. So I think it will be very hard for this Generation Z to find a good path in colleges, and many colleges and universities.
Well, I think that's a solid point, but there's something else I was thinking. As far as academia goes, because that's the problem. I think that I think that most of where these bad ideas come from is a space like academia, where I believe it's something like 80 or 85% of all the professors and staff and faculty are on the progressive end of the, you know, political spectrum, whereas only 15 to 20% are either, you know, libertarian, middle, like sort of centrist or right wing. So it's actually, there is an overwhelming side of it that's on the left. Yeah. So to the point where if you said that, they would say, no, there isn't. There's just the right that are wrong. And then there's the people with common sense. Well, no, that's because, you know, if you're overexposed to one side, you're going to think it's the normal side.
Right.
So,
absolutely.
You know, but it's not. I mean, there's clearly two sides. But what I think may change, I think that what might be changing is that because we do have the internet now, it's possible that we may see a new academia that comes out of that? Because there's already spaces on the internet that try to do that. They try to discuss, you know, things like politics and science and stuff online. There's lots of people that make YouTube channels dedicated to it. They have discussions. This is possible. So I think that the space where people get educated, where people discuss ideas, the battlefield of ideas, as it were, that is shifting from the college campus to the internet. And mm-hmm. I think that by and large, actually, a lot of the discussion probably happens on the internet compared to the college campuses, because to what you said before, it's not a place where people talk about ideas. It's a place where people memorize things and regurgitate mm-hmm. them. And that's all that, that's all there is to it.
Yes, I think that's a good point. I would like to think so, and I'd like to agree with you that online and other forms of communication that allow for direct exchange among people will replace the activity that used to take place in the classroom. Mm. We can hope so.
Oh yeah, we can hope. We'll see. I don't know, but we'll see. Those are my hopes, are that academia changes, and I don't think it's going to change in the brick and mortar sense overnight, because as you were saying, what academics do now is essentially produce more academics
that
go right back into the system and start teaching the same stuff. And what we need is somebody to diverge from that. And I think that the internet is where that happens. I mean, it's where it can happen. So, okay. Yeah. So I want to talk about, you made a book about boxing. Can you tell us a little bit about that? And why, well, first off, why did you write it? What were your thoughts on it? And then what is it about?
The book that I published last year called Modern Masculinity does have some writing about boxing in it. It actually is material I took out of the book that I'm planning on calling either Basic Boxing or The Boxer's Kiss. And it's about the way in which, when I was in my mid-60s, I decided to start training as a boxer. It came about sort of accidentally. I saw a woman throwing punches at her trainer's mitts in the gym where I worked out. I asked my trainer if I could do it. And he showed me a few things. And then he finally put these boxing gloves on me, which was sort of exciting. I'd never had boxing gloves on before. And he told me a few things about rotating to the punch. I really had no idea what he was talking about. But he finally held up his mitts and he said, okay, throw a punch. And as soon as I did, he smirked, talking about shame here. And I'd been working with him for almost 4 years. And he quickly wiped the smirk off his face and he said, no, not like that. That's more like you're slapping me. And I realized, my God, I think he told me I punched like a girl.
That's sexist, you know. You're not supposed to say that.
And at one time, I would just have kind of stopped there. And I would have thought, well, you know, I don't belong in boxing gloves anyway. But instead I said, okay, go back to square one, show me again what I need to do to throw a better punch. And I quickly saw what I was doing wrong. And I didn't have the best intention here, but I said, okay, let me try it again. And when I got a little bit better idea of what I should be doing, I threw a couple of light punches just to touch his mitt. And then slowly but steadily, I started hitting his mitt as hard as I could possibly hit it with everything. And he finally said, "Hooey, okay, we're gonna stop. That's starting to hurt. We're gonna go on to something else." But I was hooked. I had never been, you know, shamed like that before, however, you know, nicely he did it, and fought back. But this time I thought, you know what? I mean, I was paying him $90 an hour. And I thought, I'm just not going to take this remark and write this off as a failure. And I could see that I was motivated to learn how to throw a punch. And I walked out of that gym of his, and I started looking for a boxing coach. I thought that I could change the way that I related to force and violence. I had no idea how hard it was going to be, but that was what that experience of being shamed and using force, you know, controlled force within the rules of the sport to respond, that was a completely different response for me. Mm-hmm. As a gay man, I mean, usually when I was shamed about anything as a kid, I just folded up. Yeah. But I thought, you know, you're not a kid anymore. How does a man fight back here? And of course, at my age, you know, walking into boxing gyms, people take one look at you and they pretty much say, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I want to learn how to box." And I meant to box, not just to do a boxing workout. Right. And in terms of men's studies and masculinity, there is nothing quite so intense and personal.
So you're basically saying that the coach or the boxing coach, he used sort of like a form of shame to inspire you. That was his intention, I assume, to inspire you to punch back. And it worked, and you got something out of it. Like you got, like, I guess it was an adrenaline rush or some sort of dopamine thing that came out, you know, from using your strength, your body.
Sure, I got that out, but there was also a real intellectual victory over a previous self. Mm. I saw that what the boy in me would have folded up, because that's what I always did. I'm out of place here. This is not a place for men like me. And I just took that reaction. I set it aside and I said, "I'm not a kid anymore. I want to learn how to throw a punch, and I'm going to make him pay for what he said." And I did. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't abusive or illegal. I mean, he had mitts on. He was my trainer. I had never had boxing gloves on before, but I was highly motivated to learn how to throw a punch. Maybe he realized, maybe it was intentional on his part, but it was definitely intentional on my part, that I didn't have to have this shamed relationship to a violent and very masculine sport that I had. It was way out of character, but I thought, good. When you're getting to retire, that's a good time to do things that are out of character.
Yeah.
Retirement should be about discovery, and that's what it's been for me.
Okay. And your trainer, did he... Let me see how I put this. Did he give you credit where credit was due? Like when you did good, he told you that you did well, that kind of thing. Like, do you get a what I'm thinking about is cases in which you have a mentor, and the mentor is maybe they're hard on you at first, and you know they push you. I see this in the military. I remember there was a great video of these military guys, and they're all going on a run, you know, and they're carrying a bunch of heavy equipment. It's drills, and they're getting to the end of their run, and there's one military guy way in the back, and he can barely stand, and he's not able to finish, or it doesn't look like he's going to. But even though he's last in line, all the other military guys push him and push him and push him. And, you know, they stand with him. They don't help him, but they continue to, like, you know, inspire him through words of shouting at him, like, "Come on, you can do it. You can do it," right? Until he crosses the line, even though it was really slow and he collapses afterwards. But he makes it across. And despite all that, all those men in his unit or whatever it was, they all praise him for it as though he came in first. And it was really inspiring, because I think that we often have a negative view, and I think this is sort of fed through, you know, again, feminist academia and their sort of talking points, that male competition has to be like this destructive thing that tears men down if they can't keep up. And in no way can it be helpful, you know, to have someone that maybe they're better than you, or they're your teacher, and they're hard on you at first, but if you actually manage to succeed in some personal goal, even if it seems kind of something of low standing for your mentor or your peers in that particular activity, they will give you credit for it. They will, you know, be happy that you saw it through to the end. You know,
a great story, and it's definitely true that that's what a boxing coach does. If a boxing coach, I mean, there are boxing coaches who just hold mitts for their boxers and have their boxers do drills, and that's all great and that's exhausting. But the coach that I have right now is a marvelous coach. Spars with me every time we work out, which is twice a week. I spar 12 rounds, 12 two-minute rounds with him a week. And I can tell you that is a hell of a lot of boxing, and it is tough. He doesn't hit me as hard as he could. He's 43, I'm 69, so that's a good thing. But he's hard on me, and he brings out the best in me. He doesn't give me anything. And he wasn't like this when we started out working out, but he's gotten progressively tougher because he's showing me I'm getting better. It's highly motivating when your boxing coach is hard on you. And when your boxing coach treats you like, you know, all you want to do is a little cardio workout, that's not highly motivating. Getting hit and trying to figure out how to hit him, that's highly motivating. And it is very, very hard to do. Mm-hmm. I like to say that bad guys hit the people they love, and boxers love the people they hit. Hmm. And that's why boxers, you always see boxers hugging each other at the end of a round. It means thank you for the fight. You put everything on the line, I put everything on the line.
Yeah.
We're the men in the ring, and it's hard. It's hard, but I'll tell you, it has a great feeling of closeness about it, and a lot of trust. And I think that's a good example of what we talked about before, about the kind of physical intimacy that men can have. I mean, the greatest day I had in boxing so far was at the end of maybe it was the 450th round. I sparred with my current coach, and it was a good set of six rounds. He was all sweaty and I was all sweaty, and he came over to my corner and he grabbed my head in his hands and he said, "That was beautiful. I love you."
Aww.
And when I walked out on the street, I said, "Wow, hell, I can die happy." I mean, he was a real boxer. He had a lot of fights. And if, you know, that's highly motivating. Yeah. It was not that, you know, I didn't look like hell. But it was exciting that he felt that I was in some sense a worthy opponent. He sure was a worthy opponent for me. It's a great thing. I didn't have any understanding of this until I started to box. Mm-hmm. I didn't understand how violence can work to create community until I started to box.
And that's what your book is about, or at least that segment?
It is. And, you know, boxing is a lot of it is about failure. I mean, you know, I am my age. I'm in a boxing class like 2 or 3 years ago. Everybody else in the class is in their 20s. One thing I've got that a lot of them, those people didn't have is I have a real work ethic. You know, I am not going to fail. I am going to do all of these push-ups. I mean, I can do more push-ups than they do. That feels really good. You know, they've got quicker reflexes. They've got better everything. But I've got a hell of a lot of determination. And, you know, that's rewarded in this kind of training.
Yeah.
That's how it, you know, and it's a way of looking at men and a way of looking at violence that I was completely closed to before I started getting in the ring. And it's opened my eyes to a lot about the way other men live, men that I didn't know professionally.
Do you think that violence would still be the appropriate word that you would use to describe that?
Yeah, I would say it's violent.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I think this is one of those things that whenever people see the word violent, they recoil from it because it sounds like it's one person taking advantage of another. But martial arts are violent. Mm-hmm. But martial arts are arts. Boxing is a martial art, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not a brawl. It's not a bar fight in which somebody is trying to break the neck off a beer bottle so we can cut somebody's throat. There are rules in boxing. Sparring has to take place, you know, with a licensed coach. And, violence can take place within those kinds of regulated contexts. If you look at football, football is highly regulated and very violent.
Yep.
Wouldn't you call football violent?
I would. I would use that word. I was just wondering if you had thought about it. Like, I think that violence, like you were saying, it has a negative connotation associated with it, because I don't know. I think that people, it gets used in that context a lot. But
well, even before I was sparring with another coach, we were working out at a community fitness center, and the women working out at the same time went to the center management, and they said they didn't want us working out in the same place they were working out. And when the manager said, "Why?" He said, "Because they're violent." And he said, you know, they're not hitting each other. They're just doing mitt drills. And what they meant by violent was that it was noisy.
Yeah.
I mean, do these women have kids?
Well, I mean, there is a, you know, it's funny that you should bring that up, because there does seem, with boys, there does seem to be this kind of nannying, overprotective mother attitude.
That,
and it's not just with actual mothers. I mean, obviously, mm-hmm. that's where it comes from. But, you know, this is in school. This is in daycare. This is on, it's everywhere. So when you, there's a suppression of it, because I think people have, they think that if they can change boy behavior, they can eliminate violence altogether. And they don't think it should exist, right? But as to your point, you know, violence is, it's a descriptive term. It doesn't necessarily have to have a negative connotation associated with it in the way that I think most people think of.
No, moreover, boxing is not exclusively a male sport. That's
right.
Something else you need to realize. You know, some of the fiercest fights I've seen in regulation boxing matches between women.
Mm-hmm.
So this idea that somehow this is a male thing that little boys need to be protected from, you know. I another time when they didn't make us move to another place with that trainer, we were working out at one end of a gym and there was a boys' basketball class going on in the other end of the gym. And we were hearing these coaches yell at these kids because the kids had stopped playing basketball to watch the coach and me work out.
mm-hmm.
No, they never let us work in the gym again.
So, go ahead.
I'm just saying that I think you're right about the nanny attitude towards this, but it isn't only little boys who want to box.
No,
little
it's not.
Boys want to box too, and mothers and dads need to realize that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are a lot of little girls in the martial arts classes that go on in boxing gyms.
Absolutely.
And they're learning. Of regulated violence.
Mm-hmm.
So the parents better understand that they need to use violence in that sense.
Yeah.
Like you say, it's a term with a tremendous stigma attached to it, but there's a difference between criminal violence and violence in sports.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And also, well, there's also of going to war. I'm going to talk about war for a second, and maybe about war fiction, because you did write about this. And I was thinking that, you know, when we mentioned martial arts, I think a lot of people make this mistake of thinking that martial arts applies to, you know, Eastern fighting, like karate, kung fu, judo, that kind of thing. But any sort of fighting form that is, you know, either used in sport or used on the battlefield is considered a martial art, like for example, medieval knights that trained with spears and swords and shields were practicing martial arts as well. So we did it did have a use outside of sport, although it was used for sport. Like, I think did we not have things like jousting tournaments and stuff as a form of sport, but it was also a martial art?
Yes, and in fact they used those forms of sports as training. I mean, they were really important. So I, you're right. I mean, this is a common misconception. And if it comes from another culture, then it's okay because it's multicultural. But it belongs to medieval, to the Judeo-Christian tradition just as much as martial arts belong to any other tradition.
Yeah, absolutely.
And boxing is one of the most popular martial arts.
Yeah, I wonder why that is. Is it because it's? I don't know. I guess is it because it's also part maybe something to do with fitness, but it's something that most people can just do. Like, I don't know that, you know, I can throw a roundhouse kick like, you know, some taekwondo champion or anything. But I'm just curious about why it is the most popular.
Well, because it's very accessible. Mm-hmm. Boxing does not require a lot of expensive equipment, unlike a lot of other sports. You don't have to go to college or university to box. In fact, it pretty much helps if you don't, since so many colleges and universities don't have or don't want boxing teams. And boxing for a long time had very strong community roots. You know, community boxing matches were very common in England when boxing began, and they were very common in lots of rural and urban areas in the United States before television mm-hmm. took over boxing. Mm-hmm. So boxing has a kind of a community root, and there's a form of competition among boys in the neighborhood that could be regulated. Mm-hmm. And it was very accessible. You know, you didn't even need a boxing ring in order to have a boxing match. People could set up boxing rings with clotheslines and box in the backyard, and a lot of people did.
Oh, yeah. There was actually, it reminds me of a documentary that was released recently about this guy who lives in a predominantly black area, and there's a lot of gang violence there. And he set up, I believe, fight tournaments so that when rival gangs would have, you know, beef with each other, or you'd have individuals that, you know, there would be an issue that could conceivably escalate to, you know, gun mm-hmm. violence and murders and drive-bys, this guy would intervene and basically say, okay, here's how we're going to settle this. We're going to have one person fight another person in a sporting type, you know, fighting match. It was almost like a fight club. And they use it to settle differences. And it's actually, from what I understand, it was far more effective, and they actually ended up bonding.
So, because it's honorable, it's public, and it's honorable. One of the things I say in my book on modern masculinity is that there's no masculinity without an audience.
Hmm.
Two men fighting in the backyard, there's, you know, tournaments in the Middle Ages, combat in the Middle Ages was observed and reported on. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it was sort of like an official thing. What knight killed the other knight, and that kind of thing. The kind of boxing match that you're talking about that this man set up in the neighborhood is honorable because it's public, and I'm sure it was regulated. And that's a huge improvement on using violence to settle a score over gang violence. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of stories in boxing about that very kind of thing. You know, it's honorable because it's public.
Mm. So you said, what was it again? Masculinity is observed.
There's no masculinity without an audience.
Hmm.
That's, you know, that's masculinity. I talk about a scale of masculinity. You know, it could be based on intelligence. It could be based on physical strength. My previous scale of masculinity was always based on professional achievement. The most manly professor was the one who'd published the most. But in the boxing ring, you know, nobody cares who's written a book. Mm-hmm. Nobody who cares who says he don't or, you know, or he doesn't. Nobody pays any attention to that. In the boxing ring, the more manly man is the better fighter, the one who doesn't quit. And but it has to be observed, you know, that somebody sees the two men doing what they do, sees that they follow the rules, see that they fight, that they both fight honorably. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one thing about boxing that I really started to value is that there's no shame in losing. Well, two men get in the ring, one is probably going to come out a loser. That does not mean there's anything dishonorable about what he did.
Right, there's exactly. I was just going to say, it would appear that if you lose with honor, it's better than if you win without it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's some writing about boxing fiction talks about the defeated boxer as being emasculated. I mean, that sort of thing really astonishes me.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody could go 9 rounds and then get knocked out and then be considered emasculated. He's going to get up and fight another day.
Yeah.
Besides which, you know, the fact that he went 9 rounds means that he really had something on his gloves for his opponent. Losing a boxing match, coming out second in a good boxing match is not a dishonorable thing. Quitting, leaving the ring, yes, that's going to cost you honor. But getting defeated, gee, I mean, I've sparred 550 rounds with my current coach. Well, maybe I've won like 10, 15 rounds out of it because he's had all these, you know, real fights. He's younger than I am. I never feel when I get out of the ring mm-hmm. like I'm being dishonored. I mean, I look at all these other people in the gym who never get in the boxing ring, and I feel pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's sportsmanship, right? It's what we value. We value that. That is honor.
That's right. And there's no dishonor in losing.
Right.
There's no dishonor in losing. I mean, there's no emasculation in losing. It's a stupid thing to say.
That's why we have, boxers sort of like, they sort of shake hands before a match, you know, when you watch like a professional boxing thing on cable. And they're expected to, despite the fact that they just beat each other, you know, bloody, they're expected to treat each other with respect. And the fact that, as you were pointing out, there's an audience and millions watching on cable TV, I wouldn't call it pressure to behave or else, but more like an opportunity to show that whether you win or lose, you know, you're going to stay a good man. You're going to show that off. And people admire that a lot. That's why we really like movies like Rocky, where, you know, right? Because he stays a good man no matter what. He stays optimistic and he doesn't win all the time.
And I know when I am with another boxer in the ring that I am doing my best to hit him and doing my best to keep him from hitting me. And he's doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And if he hits me more than I hit him, he wins. But I also know I gave him a run for his money. And he knows I made it as hard for him as I could. I respect that. Boxers respect that. They respect the good opponent.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not a hard thing for boxers to embrace at the end of a boxing match. Because I'll tell you, it's a very small circle that they are in. It's a very small group that they have earned a place in. And for me, that feeling to come out of a physical enterprise was brand new and very invigorating. And it opened a new side up to myself as a man.
Hmm. Well, I find that really interesting. Like, I'm still sort of stuck on this, you know, masculinity is something that is observed. And you were saying that there was a scale? So
I'm saying that I like this idea of using a scale of masculinity to rank a group of men. A scale of masculinity can be based on anything from intelligence to professional accomplishment to height or skill at a particular sport. But the thing I like about it is that it is competitive, and some people are better at a certain skill like boxing than others, and they deserve credit for it. One of the things that I think the nanny state and nanny parenthood leads to is that everybody's a winner all the time. Mm-hmm. You and I know that it is not true.
Absolutely.
You know, you apply for a grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities, most of them are rejected. Mm-hmm. You know, you submit a proposal for a book to a publisher, most of them are rejected. There's a scale there too. We use scales, we use competitive scales all the time. I think it's useful to realize that there is no one scale for masculinity, but there are dozens of scales of masculinity. I do well in some, I don't do so well in others.
Yeah.
And it's honorable.
Yeah, and if you were just giving these things away, if you just let everyone have book deals, right, or you know, you made their, I don't know, you printed their albums or whatever, then how do they know that they got it through merit and hard work effort? Yeah, they never know.
They don't.
Right.
They don't because there's no competition, because there's no clear winner. Nobody likes to lose, but competition brings out the best in us. At least it brings out the best in me. You know, when I was still teaching, I wanted my students to get as much out of the classroom as they could. I prepared for every class because there was something, you know, there was something about it that made me feel I got to be ready for this. Mm-hmm. And the boxing is the same way. I'm going to get in the ring with my coach at 11 o'clock tomorrow. I'm going to be ready for him because he's going to be watching to see if I make the same mistakes I made on Tuesday, if I paid any attention to what he told me on Tuesday. That scrutiny, that's public, you know, and I think that encourages me to do my best. I can't see anything toxic about that. I can't see anything violent about that. I think it's really good.
Oh, absolutely, I think so too. I think the reason why competition is considered toxic, to progressives is that it flies against their, what's at the core of their belief system is all people, all cultures, all societies are equal. Everyone is the same. And to differentiate between people as not being the same means that you put one in a victim group and one in an oppressor group, and we don't want that. We want to level the playing field across the board for everyone. So this is the way the world should be, because I believe that all people are the same, and because they're not in a position where they're on the same footing as everyone else, then this must be a consequence of some bigotry or oppression or some exploitation. So because of that, we need to give those people a leg up, because they were treated unfair by the group that has what I perceive to be, you know, privilege, power, whatever. So when you see the world that way, then you want to eliminate things like competition and meritocracy and all of that. That's why they're against, you know, competitiveness. And that's actually, I think another thing about competitiveness is it's actually something that doesn't only exist in the physical with boxing or martial arts or athleticism in general. Like I was just at the gym, you know, lifting weights, and there are guys there that have been doing it far longer than me. And they're big guys and they're lifting lots, you know, they're doing these big deadlifts with multiple weights, and these guys are like swole, right? And I'm like, well, I have only been here a couple months. So I look at them, and a part of me is a little intimidated, but then I'm like, well, yeah, but they've been here a lot longer, and who cares? This is about my personal growth. And besides, they're competing with each other, and but I think that in most part, most people who do this stuff are competing with their former selves. Like they go there and they're like trying to beat who they were, you know, lift more than they did yesterday, that kind of thing.
Let me say this also, though. It's important that you show up and continue to show up.
Absolutely.
And they will see that, and they will feel the competition there. Mm-hmm. And they will start to see that you're a regular, and if they're not as regular as they could be, they will become more regular at the gym because there's a competitive context there. And I also want to say that in my experience, which is nearly 40 years, nobody is as envious and competitive and conscious of status as academics. Mm-hmm. Who got the interview where, whose book is being reviewed where, what big shot is reviewing so-and-so's book. In my experience, academics never quit talking about that kind of very competitive, status-oriented thing. So the idea that they're thinking about, and I agree with you, this, the world is a level playing field, believe me, these people are not only elitist, they are extraordinarily competitive and status conscious elitists.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was what I was getting at. Like you definitely, you know, it's about showing up, and they do see that, and they recognize me, and I recognize them already, you know. And to go back to what I was saying, you know, about competition, this stuff isn't just in the physical or in the intellectual, as your point about academics is, but it's also economic. And I think that one of the things about the progressives is that they're very, very anti-capitalism, because they think that capitalism is it's a competitive area as well. In fact, I think in Japan, where capitalism is a big, you know, part of their economy as well, but they also apply their sort of what they consider the samurai spirit to their, you know, capitalist endeavors, like as businessmen. They use the same mentality, and it is one of rivalry, of competition, and they use it to better, you know, each other. That's how they, I think, in many ways, for a while, I think in the 80s, they were leading in terms of technology. You know, they were making all these great technological advances, and part of it has to do with their competition with each other. So
absolutely right. I don't understand progressives trying to minimize competition, because they are, in my experience, extremely competitive people.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay, so I think, I don't know if there's anything else to talk about, but I would like to revisit talking about, you had a book about wartime. I think you had these letters from men in World War I.
Right. This is Bloody Good.
Yeah, this is from the Bloody Good book, and I think I'd like to go into that into some depth. But is there anything else that you wanted to mention that we didn't get a chance to?
You know, just very briefly, that on my website, alanjfranzen.com, I do have a section on boxing books. We can talk about that sometime too, because boxing is used with a lot more effects in fiction in particular than people think. This is something I started to see only since I have been boxing myself, and it's another way in which boxing, which seems to be so unrelated to what I did professionally, has put some new light on a professional interest of mine, which is reading literature.
Well, actually, we can talk a little bit about that. I don't mind. That interests me, if you got time.
Sure. What I was thinking about in this, a couple times it crossed my mind during our conversation the last hour or so, I remember telling a friend of mine in academia that I was starting to box, and without a hesitation, she said, "Boxers are desperate men." And I said, "Boxers are desperate men?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Gee, I see myself as a boxer. Do you think I'm a desperate man?" And, you know, I realized what she was talking about, which is this idea that the boxer is always down and out, and he needs boxing to redeem himself. That's kind of the Rocky narrative, right?
Yeah.
You know, that. So when people think about boxers, they think about abject masculinity. You know, here's somebody who's a loser, he's got a low-paying job, and boxing is how he acquires some self-respect. That's pretty much all people think about when they think about boxing fiction.
What if that's a misread of, because when I think of Rocky, I don't think of a loser. I do think of an underdog, though, but an optimistic one. But I don't know.
Go ahead. But there are a lot of other boxing movies,
sure,
in which you know, the boxer has a lot of misplaced aggression. This person all said, who said about boxers being desperate men, also said that they need boxing to get the aggression out.
It sounds like the view is that boxers are sort of like, they're sort of like prostitutes. Like they don't have it. No, what I mean is, like, they're being framed as desperate men, almost as though they have no value outside of their ability to produce violence, right? And they use it to, they exploit their bodies to, you know, to try to make a living and survive in the same way that a prostitute does.
That's a very good, connection. But it's also a very, you know, it's a very demeaning way to look at boxers.
Exactly.
It's an amazing way to look at boxers. This idea that boxing gets out aggression, you know, boxing is a very difficult sport. And somebody who is an angry boxer always loses, because angry boxers are not strategically clever. And boxing is all about strategy. Effective boxing is all about strategy, about knowing when to throw what punch or how to block a punch. People think that they don't differentiate boxing from brawling. And so I found in boxing fiction lots of sophisticated uses of boxing as a form of accomplishment, you know, from men who are otherwise highly accomplished. Like a lot of English gentlemen learned to box when they were in school, for example. So part of what I'm interested in talking about in boxing fiction is how boxing creates masculinity for successful men. People think about boxing creating masculinity for abjected men, but that doesn't describe all boxers.
No. It probably doesn't describe most.
It probably doesn't describe most, but you know, the boxers who are up there, you know, like boxing saved Mike Tyson from gangs and this kind of thing. You hear those kinds of stories. Mm-hmm. The boxing is how they acquired their self-respect. But really, a lot of boxers continue to behave disreputably even after they were, you know, prize fighters. It's just the connection of boxing to a redemption narrative that I want to offset and work against. And it's not really different from the way in which war is used to elaborate masculinity as well. You know, that a nobody goes to war and becomes a hero. That's the kind of thing that he didn't know he had greatness in him until somebody put a gun in his face or something like that. I think a lot of those kinds of narratives are very patronizing and dismissive of masculinity. And what I'm interested in doing in the kind of work I'm doing now with boxing and writing is showing how boxing creates, as I just said, boxing creates masculinity in successful men.
So it's almost like you're saying that the way that it's usually written is pretty cynical, it sounds like.
Yeah, I think it's cynical and patronizing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had to laugh at somebody who had known me for 20 years would look at me and say, boxers are desperate men. And I said, how many do you know? She said, well, just you.
Well, you know what that could be also is that could come from a sort of a snobbishness that usually comes out of intellectuals where they basically say, well, I use my brain muscle and you're just like a brute, you know, and maybe it's the only thing you can do, you know, because you're not as smart as I am.
Yes. So again, it's the man is a brute, you know, the boxer is some kind of a dumb brute. It's all, like you said, it's all he can do. Again, patronizing, dismissive, abjecting, you know, a way to look down on strong men, a way to look down on strong physical men.
On hard work, too.
A lot of discipline and a lot of punishment. You have to take a lot of punishment to be a boxer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But maybe for another time, it's been great. Spend a few minutes talking about that and talking about everything else as well. I've really enjoyed it.
Oh, well, thanks for coming on the show. And we'll definitely have you back on. I want to try, because I can't promise this, but I'd love to see this conversation. We're going to try and get Jordan Peterson on again, and maybe we can get you on with him and you guys can both talk, because I'd like to hear that conversation. So I want to thank Alan Franson for taking the time to come on the Fireside Chat today. I'm going to drop some links in the low bar to his website and to where you can find his books on Amazon. It's really good stuff. And he actually is right here in Chicago with me. Are you in Chicago or kind of outside?
North suburb, but pretty
close. Okay. So he's from the Chirac, just as I am. And thanks again for coming on, and we will talk to you guys next time.